It's a good morning to be able to gather together. Started thinking about this scripture after having a conversation this last week and turned into a one verse, brought in a whole lesson for us this morning. And kind of getting started with it, the last verse or the last chorus that we just sang of this song kind of runs it to it. The prophet of scripture, the building blocks, being able to work our way up. Since he bids me seek his face, we seek, we believe his word, we trust his grace, then I'll cast on him my every care, I wait for him. Just works right into the sermon. The prophet of scripture, and I've got these little blocks here, they're going to start to fill in as we go through the lesson, but we'll go ahead and start off with the first verse that we've got on our outline here of 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17. For most, it's going to be a very familiar verse, but something I want us to draw attention to. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. As we go through life, we gain new skills, we gain new knowledge, we are able to gain new abilities. It doesn't all come at once. We could look at this building. It takes many building blocks to get to the point of building a building. I'm not going to try that. I don't have the foundational knowledge to do it. But there are people that know how to do that. There are people that aren't going to try to do what I know how to do. And that's understandable. We each have our areas, but as something to think about when we study Scripture, whether it's for the very first time or whether it is a continual thing, whether we are a Christian or are not a Christian, I think we need to remember that there are building blocks. There are expectations as we continue down the path. And that's where Scripture can profit us if we know how to look at it and use it appropriately. And that's the idea on this one here, is that we have to realize it has great purpose. And it can be used to help us grow no matter what stage of growth we are in. And that's another key point. It can help us if we allow it to. If we open ourselves up to the scriptures themselves, and we're going to see in a passage here that, you know, we're going to do a comparison of something that, you know, I was trying to figure out how to illustrate what was in my head, and I came to Matthew chapter 14. So we're going to look at that here in just a moment as we go through this, but we have to know that there is an order to how we learn and grow. We don't start off being able to build this big building. We don't start off being able to do advanced mathematics. We have to learn the basics first. We learn addition, subtraction. Then we learn multiplication and division. Then we learn why they put the alphabet into it. I don't know, but you know, we start adding all sorts of extra things. We don't go straight to the alphabet inside of our math. We start with the very basics. There is a building block to going forward. And God has given us this pattern through his word and revealed it in this verse. And we're going to go through that as we go this day. So if you want to be turning over to Matthew chapter 14, we're going to look at it a fair amount here. But as we start off, we first start with the verse, as it says, all scripture is given by inspiration, is profitable for doctrine, the first step. Doctrine is also known as the teachings. So we look at the teaching, but what teach? Who's the teacher? What is it that we're learning? As we look at Matthew chapter 14, we actually have to back up to verse 13. In this particular spot right here, before we get into how it all relates in, we need to see the background. We see where John the Baptist at the very beginning of this chapter was actually has now been beheaded, one of Christ's best friends, someone that he knew since being in the womb. He had just been told that he has been beheaded. So naturally, when we see this in verse 13, when Jesus heard that news, he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the multitudes heard it, they followed him on foot from the cities. And when Jesus went out and saw a great multitude, he was moved with compassion for them. Think about a time in our lives. We take and have a rough patch, and sometimes we just want to be alone. Christ has been going around now for some time, giving his ministry, healing people, doing for others so much that all of a sudden something hits home to him. John is beheaded. He wants to go and spend some time alone. And the people come out to comfort him. The minister is now being ministered to. Interesting little change of events. That is the beauty of the church, is that we see it before the church is even established. God's people are to look out for one another. That is the teaching that Christ has been trying to give. He says, love one another. He's been given the love so much. Not just love, but also love through his teachings, through his actions, through his the different things going on, through all the healing. And now we have a great multitude. And I stopped reading early for a reason. There are people in this multitude who are sick. There are people in this multitude that need help, that need to hear his word, but they're not going to him to do that. They're going to him to comfort him, to do what he has taught them to do. He's been teaching them, love one another, do to your neighbor as you would have done unto you. He's taught them the principles of God, and now the great multitude went to Jesus. When they heard what happened to John, and they heard that Jesus was by himself, they said, let's go. And he saw the great multitude, and Christ was moved with compassion for them. And he healed their sick. Since you are here, since you have shown this great compassion on me, I will show it back to you. So we see this circle where it just keeps on growing and growing. His disciples came to him saying, this is a deserted place, and the hour is already late. Send the multitudes away that they may go to the village and buy themselves food. But Jesus said, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. And they said to them, we have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. He said, bring them here to me. And he commanded the multitudes to sit on the grass. And he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looked up to heaven, blessed it, broke it, gave the loaves to the disciples, and the disciples gave to the multitudes. So they all ate and were filled, and they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments that remained. Now those who had eaten were about 5,000 men besides women and children. I still want to be there to see that. How you take 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish and just start breaking it open and it just never stops going. You know, this is like one of these little magician tricks, the little spool that comes out of his mouth that never stops, or something's out of his arms. Where does this come from? How does this happen? I don't know, but they were there to see it. And it's important to come back and see this part here before we move further in the scripture, because we need to understand the teaching that Christ has given. Christ gave teachings about compassion, and we see where they listened. They heard the good news, they heard what he had to say, and they were starting to do it. Doctrine or teaching is defined as ideas or principles taught by an authority, being educated. When we go to school, we recognize a teacher as having authority over that subject that they are teaching. They have to in order to be able to teach that subject. When we listen to Christ, He says the authority has come from his Father. These are not my words, but my Father's words through me. So when we look at that, we know that he has the authority there. We can go back and look at the Sermon on the Mount, at the very last words of it. After he got done speaking, they were astonished at his authority. Astonished at his teachings, for he taught as one having authority and not like the scribes and Pharisees. When we look at this, we have to first be taught the new skill. The people have been taught words of God, but they have not been taught the meaning of those words. They have not integrated in their lives. And so Christ is teaching them what it means to live that life. He spent his ministry teaching. He spent his ministry doing. We see, this comment that he makes, a statement that he makes in John chapter 6 and verse 45. He says, "It is written in the prophets, they shall all be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned of the Father comes to me." We have to be taught by the Father. And by the Father is by his word. His word gives us that teaching. So we now have the teachings of Christ. He has taught the people. He has given us the words that we need to know. And so now we get to look at this next section of Scripture. We have his teaching. We now have the ability to look within ourselves. The other aspect of it, of all Scripture is given by inspiration of God, profitable for doctrine and for reproof. Reproof being an expression of blame or disapproval. Reproof is not necessarily me standing here in the pulpit and pointing my fingers at everybody and saying what everyone's doing wrong. That's not what Christ did either. And when he did take and point out wrongdoing, I think about the time where they wanted to stone a woman for adultery. They didn't bring the man out to stone him too. It takes two to commit that act, but they just brought the woman out. And he bent down and just started drawing in the sand. And all of a sudden, that crowd got really thin. He didn't say a word. He didn't say what everyone else was guilty of. I suspect he was writing out the sins that are in the hearts of the people that wanted to throw stones. And he let the words on the ground be the self-reflection to the people that were standing there. When we read the words of Christ, do we not see what it is that we might disapprove of within our own lives? When I look in the mirror, what do I see? And there's a nice verse that talks about that, about whether we remember what we see when we walk away from the mirror. But the thought is, when I look at the Scriptures and I look at the person in the mirror, what do I see? Do I see the Scriptures living in me, or do I see something else? Do I see something that needs to be purged? Do I see something or know something within me that needs to get away from me? I need to get it out of me. Once we have learned the correct ways, the Word can help us to see when we are in error. It's not trying to tell us what we're doing wrong all the time. It's trying to encourage us to do right. But in order to do right, we have to recognize when we are slipping, when we falter, when we have issue. And so, self-reflection says, against the Word, how am I looking? Christ spent most of his ministry teaching the pure word of God and letting it prick the hearts of those who hear it. Think about the Sermon on the Mount when he would say, "You have heard that it was said, but I say unto you." He's trying to teach the heart. He's trying to teach us what it is we ought to do. As we look at this example in Matthew, we look at verse 30. To get to verse 30, let's look at the first section here, and we see where Jesus is able to walk on the sea. Jesus takes, and once he feeds the 5,000, he immediately makes his disciples get in a boat and head towards the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes, he went up on the mountain himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking, they were troubled, saying, "It's a ghost." And they cried out for fear. No wonder we still are scared of ghosts today. Even they believed back then about ghosts, I guess. They were afraid of him. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I. Do not be afraid." This is where we had to go backwards a little bit and look at the teachings of Christ, because what would have possessed Peter to say this right here? Verse 28, Peter answered him, said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Quick question of those who know about trying to go out into the water. When you step on the water, do you stay on top of the water? That's not normal. That is not the normal way of things. If I step outside of a boat in the middle of the lake, I'm going into the water. So what would have possessed Peter to have said this? Could it be the teachings that Christ has been teaching from day one that he's been with him? Could it be that he has seen the miracles that Christ has done? They just witnessed 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish feeding 5,000 people and having leftovers. The sick being healed. They have seen Christ have power over the elements, over the natural flow of things. So for Peter to say, he has learned something. "Lord, if it is you, let me come to you." He's learned the power that Christ has. So Christ says, "Come." Peter had come out of the boat, walked on the water to go to Jesus. He walked on water. Christ is not the only one to have walked on water. Peter has now done it. But all of a sudden, we see a falter. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." In Scripture, it has the ability to reprove us. It has the ability to tell us when we are not doing right. When Peter starts to sink, he says, "I'm not doing right. Something's not right here." He started paying attention to the wind. He paid attention to Satan and the influences that he has. Satan wasn't pushing him under the water. He was just making it very windy and very contrary over here to make him afraid. So we see, "Lord, save me. I need something. I have reviewed myself, I have examined myself, and I find an issue." Reproof. And as we find out, as we get ready to move forward in this part here, we see the ability of Scripture to correct us. Because all Scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. When Peter realized that he had an issue, he has a choice to make. Stay in the issue or correct it. So when we look at correcting something, it is the act of correcting or rectifying. I hate a definition that uses its own words to define itself. What is the definition of correction? The act of correcting? What good is that? You have to know what correcting means, but of rectifying, of fixing the issue. God desires for us to succeed. That's why he gave us all Scripture. That's why he gave it by his inspired word. He gives us the instructions to see when we are wrong and how to correct it. We can take the self-reflection and use it to harden our hearts or change and submit to his will. Think of what Pharaoh did. We've been studying about one Pharaoh in a Bible study that was with Joseph. He opened his heart to Joseph and to God and to allow that to happen. But yet a Pharaoh that will come soon after this knew not Joseph, knew not the God of Israel, and hardened his heart against the Israelites. So we have two options. We can either go with God or away from God. And so we see here when Peter starts to sink, he says, I need correcting. I have seen the reproof within me. I need to be corrected. He said to Christ, Lord, save me. So in verse 31, we see, and immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? He gives us what we need for correction. He says, why did you doubt? That was his real issue. When our goal is to walk straight, why do we look to the side? That's what Peter did. His goal was to walk out to Christ. But instead of walking to Christ, he was trying to walk that way, but he was looking over here at the winds and the waves. The goal is in front of us, not over here. Why did you doubt? Why did you look away? Why did you turn away? The correction is, put our focus back where it needs to be. We can do this in our lives today. We can do this at any stage of life. Even Paul, I've thought about him a little bit as the example when he saw on the road to Damascus. His life was going against the scriptures. He learned about it, the truths of it. He saw, had that time of reflection. He had the ability to correct himself. He had the ability to then learn the instruction in righteousness. The same thing with Peter right here. Next thing they do immediately is they go back to training. When we correct ourselves, we have to make sure we don't make the same mistakes twice, right? We don't want to keep making that same mistake over and over and over. Instruction in righteousness. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. He's not here just to tell us when we do wrong. He wants us to do right. And to do right, he wants us to know that ahead of time. To define out instruction or training in righteousness, it is the action of teaching a person or animal a particular skill or type of behavior. Again, think about going back to the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard that it was said, but I say unto you. When God says in the Old Testament through his prophets that they will write my words on their doorposts, they will write them on their eyelids, they will meditate on them day and night. Most people don't hear something one time and just have it. We sometimes need to be reminded. We have the teachings in the beginning. Sometimes it's a rocky start for us to get on board with the full thing, and then we need that instruction in righteousness. What does that teaching mean in real life? That's where I like to be able to sit down and listen to someone or work on a workshop where they not only tell me how to do it, they show it. Do you know why I'm standing here today? It's not because someone taught me what the Bible had to say. That was part of it. They taught me the Bible. They allowed the Bible, the inspired Word of God, to reprove me in the mirror. They helped me with the corrections. And they aided me with the instruction. And the instruction was not just by word of mouth. It was also by their actions. It took both sides of it, the speech and the action, working as one. Do we do what we say? When we listen to the Master, we gain benefits of his teaching. Think of Mary and Martha sitting there listening to him in their house. Mary was complimented for sitting and listening. How many were delighted when Christ came to town? When Christ was near, the 5,000 went out to him when they heard that he was alone. When we're able to walk as he walks, talk as he talks, we can be pleasing in the sight of God. When we stop and think about what happens next with Peter and those that are there, Peter had jumped out of the boat very eager. I remember my teachings. You have taught me. Let me come to you. He did. He was weak in his faith at first. He started to doubt, but then Christ gave him correction. Why did you doubt me? And now, what is it that they immediately do? When they got into the boat, the winds ceased. Then those who were in the boat came and worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." They worshiped him. And I would believe that in part of this worship, that not just the part of coming and growing close to him, but would also be listening to all that he had to say. Looking at what is there so that they might be able to be trained further. There are a lot of models of how to train somebody or of doing something. You know, first off, we have to have the hearing of it. We got to know how to do it. Sometimes we have to be hands-on. Sometimes in that we might have to be guided a little bit. Eventually we get used to it and we can do it ourselves. And then we can teach someone else how to do it as well. When we get good at it, we're able to do it without thinking about it. It's a building block. It's a stepping process. Sometimes it takes training. And maybe a little bit different types of training. But as we go through this, we have each of these elements. As we think about these building blocks, the reason that they are important, the reason we know that God loves us is because first, he starts the verse by all scripture has been inspired, is given by the inspiration of God, and is profitable. This is where we go, you know, it's profitable for what? For doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Why is it that so important? As we finish off, we look at it and we see that this is all to enrich our lives because the rest of it says that the man of God may be complete, whole, missing nothing, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Whatever our talents are, whatever our primary focuses are, whatever we're able to do well, as long as we are able to be equipped to every good work. Maybe it isn't something we are proficient in. Maybe leading a Bible study is uncomfortable, but we are still equipped for every good work. There are some preachers that'll come up into the pulpit and will read a lot of scriptures and let the scriptures speak for themselves. When you have good material, why come up with something else? When we look at God's word, it gives us everything we need to be complete if we allow it to fill us. That's the trick. Do we allow God's word to fill our hearts so that we might be able to be complete, equipped for every good work? Scriptures give us the various levels to profit, to enrich our lives and serve God. The focus of all this that God gave us so we can be complete. The question is, have we heard the teachings of Christ? Have we listened to his doctrine, to his teaching? Do we see where we need to make corrections in our lives, and have we done them? Do we continue in the instructions of righteousness? Do we continue to learn more of Him, dig deeper into the Scriptures, find more meanings so that we can be about our Father's business? Think of that one little statement that Christ made as an adolescent. The family went back to the temple when He was still a child. A couple days later, they found out He wasn't coming back home with them. They had to go back. Found Him in the temple, reasoning with the scribes and the Pharisees and the religious leaders, astonishing them at His knowledge. And when He was asked why He wasn't with them, He said quite simply, "Don't you know I must be about my Father's business?" Are we about the same? Do we see the profit that Scripture gives to our lives? Are we able to use it to enhance our lives? It's not about finding our faults. It's about fixing ourselves to be stronger. It's about finding ways to encourage ourselves and to encourage others. As we study with others, do we remember that it's a building block? We have to learn before we can see the errors to be able to correct them and to be able to move forward in righteousness. As children of God, do we not see the same thing in ourselves? Remembering each and every day is another opportunity to do the same for ourselves. Do we grow? Do we need help in that growth? We're here to help. If we need to be able to start that process, we're here to help as well. If anyone has needs of the invitation, we encourage it at this time while together we stand and sing.